Spurs last season, complaining of what Spurs doctors decided was no more than a thigh bruise. He wound up in the East playing against a hobbled, sick Embiid and overrated Giannis. Crime pays. Well, CJ McCollum came to Kawhi's defense tweeting this. Give it a rest, Skip. Get some sleep, man. Claw is a monster. Get that hate out your heart. So, Skip, what is your response to CJ?
You know, my first response is that I was surprised that CJ isn't still in hiding after his disappearing all those fourth quarters of all those games. I'm just saying, you realize CJ, I called him out on the show. Maybe that's why he's responding. But in the fourth quarters against Golden State, he went 1-for-10 as they blew leads of 17, 18, and 17. That's 1-for-10 from three. And he went 1-for-5 from the free throw line. But that, neither here nor there.
Okay.
Now, when it comes to me, CJ has no idea what he is talking about. I'm going to reiterate for all of our viewers out here, out there who are coming late to this story. Nobody loved this guy more than I did.
I know.
I was way ahead of the curve on this guy. Way ahead. When it was not even remotely fashionable, I was the one singing his loudest praises on ESPN. This started in 2012. You can go check the tapes if you want to. I'm raving about the kid they stole in the draft. I called it. Go back to 2012. I was calling it the steal of the century. R.C. Buford, pilfered this guy from Larry Bird and the Indiana Pacers. And the throw-in and the trade for George Hill is George Hill for these two guys. Davis Bertans, who much of the year this year led the NBA in three-point shooting and averaged 22 minutes a game for my Spurs. So is that not a steal? And the guy I saw early on, the young number two, was in a shell. He had no confidence. He had no real faith in his basketball ability on offense. He was all defense at San Diego State. And the Spurs brought him out of his shell.
Okay.
Duncan, Ginobili, and Parker taught this young man how to do it, how to be a pro, how to believe in yourself, how to play at the highest level in the biggest games.
Okay.
Because those are three pretty great teachers, okay, right?
Yeah.
Three cinch Hall of Famers.
Mm-hmm.
So what started happening? They have a shot doctor coach on the Spurs who is simply the best in the business.
Hmm.
He will fix or teach anybody how to shoot. And he started with this kid just the way he did with Tony Parker, who didn't have much of a shot and developed a deadly mid-range game. Chip
a really
England.
Good push shot.
Chip England. Well, he did, but it worked, man. He made a lot of big shots and a lot of big games. Chip England taught number two how to shoot. He didn't have much of a stroke. His hands are actually too big to be a good shooter. I marvel at what he's doing now, but it tears my heart out because the Spurs taught all of this. The stroke that you see from three right now, even though it's been pretty awful of late, but the stroke from the free throw line, they taught him this. They made him what he was. And then what happened right on schedule? What happened was that in 2018, but let's go back to 2017, all of a sudden, Greg Popovich decided you are ready to take over this team. I am screaming his praises on this show in this seat. I am calling him the best two-way player in basketball, and you are ridiculing me for having that opinion. You're scoffing.
No.
You're criticizing.
No. You said he was the best player in basketball.
I said best two-way.
No, he's the best two-way. I mean, his hands down. But you said he had to pass LeBron because he could do things LeBron can only dream of.
Well, he locked up LeBron several times
in
big games.
Don't do that.
Okay, well, I'm just saying. Now you switch around. Now you're speaking out of both sides.
No, I'm not. No.
The point was, even our man Chris Broussard, 2017, is proclaiming he is going to win MVP. And I'm second in the emotion. I'm pounding the desk over here saying, here he comes. And what happened right on schedule? Uncle Dennis happened, as in Dennis Robertson, the uncle in his family who took over all of his business and professional affairs.
Yep.
And right on schedule, I believe two things happened. Number two, crumbled under the pressure to become the man. He doesn't have the right psyche for it. It's not in him. And all of a sudden, he's looking around like, really? I got to be Tim Duncan here? Obviously, Duncan had retired.
If you don't mind me asking, what part did the injury play in that at the end of 2017?
Okay. Well, we're about to get into that. Okay. Because number two, Dennis Robertson, clearly to me, wanted him out of small market San Antonio. Dennis Robertson is based in New Jersey, and my gut feeling is, and this has been reported repeatedly over the last 2 years, that Uncle Dennis wants number two up in the New York area, either Knicks or Nets. We'll see how that plays out, okay. But that would be his wish, his best wish. So what happened? The Spurs did not like Uncle Dennis interfering here, and Uncle Dennis convinced, I believe, number two, that he had some serious issue in his thigh. It was a thigh bruise, according to the San Antonio team doctors. I'm going to put this in perspective one more time. This is the most player-friendly franchise in all of sports. Greg Popovich rests players to a fault. He will give you as much line as you need. If you need 100 yards of line, if you need 3 weeks off, take it. We just want you ready for the playoffs. But after he'd missed the first half of the year, when we got into late January, the Spurs medical staff, and I did speak to one doctor about this, said, we can't find anything. We can't find it. I heard that right in my ear from one of the doctors. We can't find anything. So what am I supposed to think? Is it psychosomatic, or is it just the pressure has gotten to him, or does Uncle Dennis want an excuse to get him out of there? You realize this has never happened in the history of the San Antonio Spurs. They've never had a player go south. Go back and look at their history in this regime. Find one for me. It's the classiest, most stable organization in all of sports, and he turned it upside down. And trust me, that team, I kept saying all year, this team had a chance to win the championship. It was the end of Ginobili and Parker, but they still had plenty left where if you had the best player, and he was certainly the best, and you had LaMarcus Aldridge, and we can go down the roster, you had enough firepower to overcome Golden State, because I think they were going to overcome them the year before until Zaza Pachipshot happened. So what happens in late January? They publicly declare him cleared to play. You are cleared for all basketball activities. And what did he do? No, I'm hurt. And what did Uncle Dennis tell our man Chris Haynes on Yahoo? Yeah. Uncle Dennis yesterday, Dennis Robertson, said to Chris, I think it just became a lack of trust. They didn't believe Kawhi couldn't play, and that caused a lack of trust in us and then us not believing in them. Anytime a player says he's not capable of playing, you should believe him. Sometimes you get these team doctors telling you what you can and cannot do, and I won't say his name, was just in too much pain to get out there. Baloney. I'm just calling baloney on him because that medical staff, if they thought he was hurt, they wouldn't do this. So it's not hate in my heart. It's just that he betrayed my organization. He betrayed them. He missed 73 games, and finally they called him.
82.
They called him on the carpet. This is all the way into deep March. Tony Parker, Ginobili, called him on the carpet in a players-only team meeting in the locker room.
How'd that work out for him?
Yeah, well, it didn't work out well, I guess, because two cinch Hall of Famers said, hey, man, we just need to know, are you with us or not?
Not.
And he said, I don't know, man. I don't know what he said. He probably just grunted and didn't say much of anything.
Not. Yeah. Skip, look, you love movies, and you just brought it up the other day. You watch Rounders.
Mm-hmm.
And Teddy KGB in the final scenes in which Mike, Matt Damon's character, mm-hmm. he flops the nuts mm-hmm. in the poker term,
yep.
which he's got the best hand that he can't be beat now.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And on the river, it came an ace. Yep. And Teddy KGB says, all your effing dreams just goes down the mm-hmm. drain. And that's what you saw on Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
All your hopes and dreams of the Spurs going back to the NBA mm-hmm. Finals.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Down the drain.
So the reason I called it in the end of my tweet that crime, quote unquote,
pays, it wasn't no crime.
It's basketball crime. That's what took place against the classiest organization in sports. And it would be like this, and I know CJ won't be able to get this through his head, but what if, I know this is going to seem outrageously out there, what if Damian Lillard, for whatever reason, he just wanted out of Portland starting next year. He decided, I can't win with CJ. Maybe he thinks CJ won't come up clutch enough for me to give me enough help in fourth quarters. What if he just suddenly had some mysterious injury and he said, I don't know, man, I just can't play.
Right.
What if he dogged it for the whole year? What if he just said, I'm out because I need out of Portland?
Hmm.
What if it got so bad that they finally said, I guess we have to trade him because he just won't play for us anymore? How would CJ going forward feel about that? Would he be able to get the quote-unquote hate out of his heart?
Yeah.
I'm always going to take
the word of a player mm-hmm. because this is what I'm looking at. I'm looking at game five. They're down 14 points.
Yeah.
Let's go back. Mm-hmm. You're down 0-2. You're struggling, and Kawhi's laboring in game three. That's a perfect opportunity for him to quit. Mm-hmm. But he didn't do that. Mm-hmm. In game five, they're down 14 points.
Why was he laboring? Why was he limping?
Hold on, Skip. Hold on.
He wasn't hurt.
Skip, I just gave you the floor. I just want the floor right now. Just give me a couple of minutes. Just give me that. That was an opportunity for him to quit. Down 15 in the third quarter, he had every opportunity to quit. Mm-hmm. And he said no. Skip, I know what it's like. And see, when I told you when this happened, I say Kawhi has an implosive personality. Mm-hmm. But what that means is he won't say anything. He'll go and you'll keep pushing him and you'll keep pushing him. Mm-hmm. I say when he explodes, he's gone. I say he's done with this. Done. I know that type of personality. Mm-hmm. And I also know being a professional athlete, when a doctor tells you, you should be able to do something. This is my body. I get it that you went to the best medical schools in the country and you can give me a prognosis. But you can only give me a prognosis of what you think. I'm telling you what I know. I'm telling you what I feel. Kawhi said, I'm not right. And you should have took him at his word. Because what did Skip?
It was going to go south anyway. It just wasn't going to work. There was no word or not word.
It went south when Greg Popovich pushed Tony Parker and Manu Ginobili to have the meeting. It went south when
I'm not sure he did, but go ahead. I don't know that for a fact.
When Tony Parker opened his big mouth and talked about, I had an injury that was 100 times worse, that started it.
Was it not 100 times worse? Tony Parker ruptured his quadriceps.
Okay.
Ruptured it.
Yes.
It tore in two in a playoff game against Memphis the previous year.
He did.
He rushed back, and it curtailed the end of his career because he fought back to play that year way too prematurely, and he's still feeling the effects of it.
Skip, let me tell you
fought back. The other guy wouldn't fight at all.
But hold on. Brother can never speak out against me. My sister could never speak out against me.
Okay, but and Tony Parker had decided at that point they weren't a team.
Okay,
right?
What Kawhi said, okay, since that's how we doing it.
Well, that was the end of it.
Okay,
he was out the door.
There you go.
Yeah.
So with that being said, Skip, and everybody seeing it right now, it's hard. What you think R.C. Buford, looking at what he got in return, because you're never going to get that value. What do you think Greg Popovich, because there's no question in my mind, that guy right there on the Spurs, they're playing the Golden State Warriors in the Western Conference Finals.
Well, why not?
Yeah.
They're pretty good anyway. They came with one crazy shot from Jamal at the end of the Denver game, right?
And you know what, Skip? And the Teddy KGB, all your hopes down the drain. Mm. It's over for you, the Broccoli Spurs.
He lost.
He lost what?
Teddy lost.
That's what I'm saying. But my thing, you lost. Thank you. You lost. Mm-hmm. All your hopes and dreams are going down the drain, Skipper. You watching it.
Here's what makes me the sickest. This is where crime pays.
Tell us.
All of a sudden, it feels meant to be because a lot of times the playoffs get dictated by circumstance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What's happening to the team that loses? You agreed with me all year. Joel Embiid is the real monster in the East. When he's not sick or hurt, he's the best player in the East. You cannot tell me if he had been 100% right against Toronto that Philly wouldn't have won because they almost won anyway without him, and he was sick or hurt half the games, right?
Sure.
Okay, so that's like meant to be. That's like good luck to somebody who doesn't deserve it. And Giannis is just... he's just overrated. So I nailed it in my tweet. A hobbled, sick Embiid, and you got an overrated Giannis. I was astounded by how handicapped Giannis is when he can't just get to the rim. He's got no game.
You watched him all year, Skip.
Yeah.
But why can't the... hold on. This is what I'm having. I'm being puzzled by this. Skip tells me that the Spurs is the classiest organization in all of basketball.
Sure.
They tell me that the doctors are the most cautious in all of basketball.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't you wish Kawhi good health and good and a great
after
job?
He did that.
Hold on. Why can't you do for him what the Grizzlies did for Mark Gasol?
Oh.
We riding with you, Mark.
Oh,
Mark Gasol said for Zach Randolph, for all the guys that were in Memphis with me, this is for us.
Time out. They got rid of Gasol. He didn't ask out. They pushed him out. They said, we got to start over. We got to go young.
You pushed Kawhi out. Because if you'd have kept your mouth shut, he'd have been happy.
We did everything in our power.
No, you didn't.
Everything in our power to make him happy.
You tried to force him to play. You tried to force him to play.
Who wouldn't? He was making $20 million. At some point, you just say, come on, man, what's up?
Hold on. How much is LaMarcus Aldridge making? What's that money to them?
LaMarcus Aldridge last year played 81 of 82 games.
Okay. Can you imagine, Skip?
Okay, so what? You eat $20 million for 1 year in order to get another 6 or 7 years. What's the investment?
Okay, but he wanted out because Uncle Dennis wanted it out.
I don't believe he wanted out.
I do.
He wanted out once y'all started bumping them gums.
Okay.
Since Tony Parker opened his big mouth. Hold on. And at the end of the day,
huh.
Tony Parker's trying to be the great company man. Skip Bailey, if you don't mind, because there are people at home that don't know this.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell the people at home where Tony Parker's playing at currently?
Mm-hmm.
The company man that rose for his company, the company let him go.
Yeah, well, he got more money there, but he was just a shell of himself after he rushed back. He's still not right, and I don't think he's ever going to be right.
Greg,
he rushed back.
He rushed back, and Greg,
the other guy rushed out.
He rushed back to be let go sooner because Greg Popovich told him, your role will be greatly diminished here. The company guy.
Mm.
That's why you keep your mouth shut, players, and stop riding for these corporations. Yeah.
Well, last quote, comment to CJ.
Please.
Come on, CJ. No, CJ, go stop. I'm going to try to get CJ. CJ, go come on here.
He says, come on, the claw is a monster.
Claw.
I was screaming that from the rooftops in 2012 about the claw being a monster. Yeah. So I'm way, way ahead of you. Before you even knew who the claw was, I was screaming about
it. Did you see that? I think it was game five. They threw him, he was in the post, and they threw it to him. He caught it, palmed it in midair, stuck it out, brought it back.
I saw it for 7 years.
I thought it was magic. I said, how did he do that?
My final comment is, if you're a Spurs fan and you are rooting for this guy right now, then you're not a Spurs fan.
Yes, you are.
No?
Yes, you are, Skip.
All right.
Sorry.
Yes.
There you have it. We got the response. We needed to hear it. We're going to stay talking about Kawhi, though. You're stuck with him all day.
You gave the right name, number two, because he's the
He is the king of the North right now, but hey, could he leave for L.A. this summer?
Good question.
Oh, you hoping.
Good
question. Now you hoping.
Good question.
Now you hoping. And I won't back down.